Welcome to another video. This is Mike Hansen, and in this video, I'm going to talk about, do ventilators actually save patients' lives? So as a lung doctor and an intensive care unit doctor, I see patients in the hospital who are the sickest of the sick. Patients come to the intensive care unit who are on the brink of death, and sometimes they live and sometimes they die. Based on a recent study that came out only a few weeks ago, only 14% of people who have COVID-19 who require a breathing tube end up surviving. So COVID-19 patients who end up getting ARDS in any intensive care unit who need to get a breathing tube, only 14% of them end up surviving. But let's talk about why that is. In order to understand why, we have to know more about COVID-19 and how it affects the lungs. We have to understand mechanical ventilation, and we have to understand the bridge between those two things, ARDS, acute respiratory distress syndrome. Let's start out by talking about why does someone need a breathing tube in the first place? Because there's only one of four reasons why someone needs it. And usually it's gonna be either one, two, three, or four of these reasons why someone ends up getting intubated with mechanical ventilation. The first one is gonna be hypoxemia, or hypoxia, meaning low oxygen levels. Now, hypoxia by itself doesn't necessarily buy someone a breathing tube. When someone has low oxygen levels and we can't get those oxygen levels up by other means, such as with a nasal cannula or high flow nasal cannula or with a BiPAP mask, when people don't get better with their oxygen, we have no choice but to put that breathing tube in and have them on a ventilator. So that's one reason. Another main reason why we put a breathing tube in is because someone's carbon dioxide levels are too high, meaning their CO2 levels. So a couple of common scenarios where that's an issue is when, for example, someone has a drug overdose and they're not breathing because of that drug in their system. Well, in that case, they start to accumulate high levels of CO2. And if they're not gonna breathe that CO2 off on their own, they need a breathing tube in order to do that. Another common scenario is with COPD emphysema, where they're just not able to breathe off that CO2 because they're trapping air within their lungs, and eventually they need a breathing tube in order to accomplish that. The third scenario is when someone has a high work of breathing. So, for example, let's say someone who's having a severe asthma attack or severe exacerbation of COPD, for example. In that case, lots of times they are breathing at a rate of 30s to 40s, meaning 30 times per minute, 40 times per minute. And they're also using what we call accessory muscles of breathing. So normally when we breathe, we're just using our diaphragm that does most of the work. But when someone's really working hard, they're also using their abdominal muscles, they're using their sternocleidomastoid muscles here, and they're also using the muscles that are around their ribs. So that's three reasons. The fourth reason why we put a breathing tube in someone is because they're so obtunded for whatever reason that they're not able to protect their airway. Meaning, for example, let's say someone is very, very drunk to the point where they're totally unconscious. In that scenario, they could vomit whatever's inside their stomach, probably what they're drinking, and then it goes up the esophagus from their stomach, and then it goes down into their trachea, the windpipe, and down into the lungs. And that can cause a severe inflammatory reaction within the lungs. It can cause aspiration pneumonitis, can cause ARDS. So that's the fourth scenario. Another example of the fourth scenario is, let's say someone has a big time stroke where they just lose consciousness, something like that, and they're not able to protect their airway. It's the same thing. Those patients will need a breathing tube in order to protect their airway. So those are the four indications for a breathing tube. So with COVID-19 patients who have ARDS, their oxygen levels are too low, and usually they're breathing fast where their work of breathing is up as well. And so really they have at least one, probably two reasons to be intubated. With COVID-19 patients, for the ones who do get ARDS, what happens is the virus latches on to these ACE2 receptors within the body, within the lungs, and ultimately it triggers this crazy, chaotic, inflammatory reaction within the lungs. It's primarily within the lungs, but the immune system affects the entire body, and the whole reaction affects other organs as well. So all the organs, or most of the organs, will become affected, but the main organ that's affected is the lungs. So acute respiratory distress syndrome, it has a lot of different causes, not just COVID-19, but also, if you remember, with the vaping lung injury, that was a cause of ARDS. As I mentioned before, when someone aspirates, causing aspiration pneumonitis, that can cause ARDS. Pneumonia in general, whether it's bacterial or viral, that can cause ARDS. And in order for us to make the diagnosis of ARDS, it's basically four criteria to meet that diagnosis. It's one, having low oxygen levels, specifically, a PO2 to ratio of less than 300. So what that is the air that someone inhales, that's going to be a certain percentage of oxygen. So this air right here is 21% oxygen. When we're giving someone more oxygen in the hospital, supplemental oxygen, that's higher percentage of oxygen. So whatever they're breathing, we determine how much oxygen is in that air that they're breathing. That's going to be your FiO2. Now, when we do an arterial blood gas, meaning we stick a needle in the artery and then we sample that artery, send it off to the lab, and we measure the oxygen within the artery, we can determine exactly how much oxygen is within your arteries. So what we do is we divide those two. That's how we get the ratio. FiO2 is how much you breathe in, and then you have the oxygen level, the PO2 in the blood. So the PO2 divided by the FiO2, that's going to give you a certain number. It's going to be a certain ratio. And if that number is less than 300, that meets the criteria for ARDS. So that's one criteria. The other criteria is if it's acute, meaning if this process happens quickly, within a couple days, usually it's hours. The third criteria is when you have bilateral fluffy infiltrates on chest x-ray, or the bilateral patchy ground glass opacities that are seen on the CT scan. And then the fourth criteria is we have to determine that all this inflammation and x-ray findings in the lungs are not due to the left side of the heart not failing. So we get an echocardiogram, an ultrasound of the heart, and determine if that left side of the heart is functioning properly. So if we see that left side of the heart functioning properly, we can say that this is going to be ARDS as long as all those other criteria are met. So we know what ARDS is now. The thing is, can we do something to treat it? And the answer is yes. There are a few keys to managing patients who have ARDS and are on mechanical ventilation. The first key is actually to use low lung tidal volumes. The way that I'm breathing right now, I inhale normally and I exhale normally, the same way that you're breathing, and that's called tidal volume. And for most people, that's around 500 cc's or so. That's about half a liter. And when we do tidal volumes for patients on mechanical ventilation who have ARDS, we shoot for lower lung volumes. The exact scientific answer is 6 cc's per kg per body weight, and that usually ends up coming out to about 300 cc's for women, and 400 range, meaning 400 cc's for men. So that's lower than your typical tidal volume that you and I are breathing. And because that's lower than what we're breathing, it's uncomfortable for the patient. So lots of times we have to give patients sedation in order to make them comfortable, in order to breathe with that lower lung tidal volume. Now, sedation by itself isn't always enough. Some patients will require paralysis, meaning we have to give a medication that causes them to be paralyzed temporarily. And what that does is it allows the patient to be synchronous with the ventilator. If we don't do that, they won't be synchronous with the ventilator, and that's actually not conducive to them getting better. So not all patients require paralysis. It's actually, generally speaking, a pretty small percentage. But when the ARDS is typically severe or moderate to severe, we do sometimes have to give paralytic agents. Now, you've probably seen some horror movies where someone was paralyzed, but they're awake. So we try to avoid that at all costs. We give them sedation whenever we give them a paralytic. That way, their mind isn't awake during that time. So the other key to managing patients with ARDS is having a high PEEP level, meaning positive end expiratory pressure. All that is if you were to take a deep breath And then right when you're about to let that breath go out, you cover your mouth and your nose. And you'll feel that with inside, there's a pressure inside your chest. And that pressure that's in there when you do that is your PEEP. So the studies have shown that ARDS patients who have higher PEEP levels, and we dial that on the ventilator, when we have higher PEEP levels on the ventilator for patients with ARDS, they have better rates of survival. The only downside is you have to be careful you don't give someone too much PEEP, because that can puncture their lung and their lung ends up becoming like a flat tire. And that's not good. That can make the situation much worse. So there are a couple other things that we often do for ARDS that may improve ARDS. When someone has severe ARDS, we typically give steroids. So in the form of corticosteroids, meaning solumedrol, which is methylprednisolone. The other thing we do sometimes is prone positioning. We do that if they have moderate to severe ARDS. So prone positioning means, okay, when you're in a hospital, you see someone lying in a bed, they're always lying on their back, right? Well, with prone, we flip them over so they're lying on their chest. And what that does is it takes the weight of the heart off the posterior, meaning the back of the lung regions. And it also lifts a little bit of that pressure off the diaphragm and the lower lung regions. So what you end up getting is more compliant lungs, meaning the lungs are able to expand, deflate and inflate back and forth easier. Sometimes we do other modes of mechanical ventilation, which gets pretty complicated, so I'm not going to dive into. But if you want to look it up, there's airway pressure release ventilation, there's inverse ratio ventilation. Typically not something that we do, but sometimes we have to when we have no other choice to try and get their oxygen levels higher. So with COVID-19 patients who have ARDS who require mechanical ventilation with a breathing tube, their average time on the ventilator is 17 days. And like I mentioned earlier in this video, only 14% of those who get the breathing tube actually survive.